Hello, good evening, and welcome to our session, wherein we have got two esteemed guests with us, and they are from a segment which is, you know, you need real guts to be in. And this particular chat program is facilitated by Vicky Karnataka.
So, as they say, behind every successful woman is a tribe of successful women. And here at Vicky, we have a collective strength of over 250,000 women in over 120 countries. Vicky Karnataka Human Resource Council is a part of Vicky, a national business chamber, whose endeavor is to boost and build women's entrepreneurship and business through greater engagement with government, institutions, global trade, and networks.
Vicky Karnataka, the Human Resource Council, is an ambitious initiative by a team of accomplished women from various organizations and diverse walks of life. This team is headed by Shikha Gupta, who's the president, and Rani Srinivasan, who is the vice president. This council strives to create a platform where women can make a difference and touches upon pertinent topics, current events, sensitive issues, and much more. And I'm Kalasa Dasivam, who's one of the moderators for today's chat show.
And hello, I am co-moderator Taru Girdonia.
So first, I'm just starting with introducing our esteemed speaker. Just a second. Yeah. I'm just introducing our esteemed speaker, who is Vandana Suri, who calls herself as the Woman Cabbie. She is the founder of Taxi, a woman cab organization which focuses on safe mobility of women and children. Apart from this, she also has more challenge, you know, change organizations. One of them is Single Sisters, a community for single women, and the other one, Chop Chop Boys. Well, that's nothing but and say for the men to learn basics of cooking.
And with us also is Ms. Janvi Kulkarni, founder Kale Nele, a venture aiming to shelter, nurture, and grow the demand for various fabrics and handicrafts. Re ma re ma re pa ma pa ma pa ma ni pa ni pa ni pa sa ni sa ni sa ni re sa re ma ma ni sa ni pa ni ni sa ma ni ni sa ma ni 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 sa 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 ni 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 sa 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 ni 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 sa 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 ni 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 sa 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 ni 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 re 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 ni 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 ma 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 ni 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 sa 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 re 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 sa 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 ni 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 sa 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 ni 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 pa 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 ni 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 pa 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 ma 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 pa 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 ma 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 re 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 ma 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 re 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 sa 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 ni sa re sa ni sa re ma re sa ni sa re ma pa ma re sa ni sa re ma pa ni pa ma re sa ni sa re ma pa ni sa re ni sa re ma re shri What a lovely presentation. So Janvi and Vandana, we would love to hear a bit about your journey in your own words. So if we can begin with Janvi, and Vandana, you can continue from there.
Okay, I am from a small town called Dharwad in North Karnataka, born to parents who were passionate physicists. So the general expectation was that I also carry on a career either in technology or medicine. I mean, you know, something that the family was used to that way. But my passion was textiles, and that took me to SNDT, and from where I graduated with a gold medal in 1998. And I always wanted to kind of work with Indian textiles. Initially, I did have a stint with an export market where I worked with linen fabric for European and UK markets. And then marriage brought me to, all this was in Mumbai. And from there, I moved to Bangalore after marriage. And then there I joined an organization called Yamini that was the first indigenous home furnishing brand, which was trying to work with Indian handlooms and handicrafts, contemporize it and present it to the current market and, you know, for the art connoisseurs. So I joined there as a designer, and then that allowed me to travel to different clusters in India where I mean, you know, we used to work with the karigars, artisans, weavers, and help them kind of contemporize with what they were known to the art form, and then create for home furnishing products for the store. And that's when I realized, when I traveled all over India, that Karnataka handloom and handicrafts are the least explored, especially the northern Karnataka. And that led me to, think that if anything I want to do, I would want to create an identity for these arts and crafts. And then family requirements made me to take break for a few years. And post which, I was very sure I want to start something on my own with the arts and crafts of Karnataka. So that's where the Kale Nele was started in 2012 November. Kale is art and Nele is shelter, the name in Kannada. So that's what we espouse to be. We try and create a kind of a shelter to the different forms of arts and crafts of our state. So that's what, it's been a wonderful and challenging journey of 9 years, or close to 9 years now, wherein from just creating home furnishing products, because that was what was the market I was used to. So it was very easy to move from known to unknown. So the first thing what I did was to create home furnishing range using this fabric. And then the Craft Council of Karnataka was, very, very helpful and supportive, and told us, why don't you start weaving in the region saris and other things? Now that you know the weavers and weavers trust you, I think you should kind of get to doing that. And that's when, we carry out a lot of development works, innovations on the looms in northern Karnataka, and also convert them into different kind of products that work for individual usage, personal accessories, home, corporate gifting, and various kind of other markets that we have been able to create with the arts and crafts of Karnataka. So a long way to go. So far we've been able to probably just, touch the tip of the iceberg. A long journey to go, but then it's been a very fulfilling, journey so far. Yes.
And Vandana, we'd like to hear from you. Vandana, we're not able to hear
Vandana,
you.
Vandana, you're on mute.
Yeah, sorry about this. Technology barrier. Are you able to hear me now?
It's a bit low. Maybe we'll just have to speak a bit louder.
Okay. So my journey has been a bit of a graph as far as career is concerned. I was an investment banker, and I was bubbling with too much energy. I had to do something different in my life. And one fine day, there was a rape in an Uber in Delhi, which really triggered me. And, the headlines came the next day that if there was a woman driving me, this would not have happened. And that really triggered me to start out taxi. Are you able to hear me, Karu?
Yes.
Yes, it's a little faint, but we're able to hear you.
Yeah, louder.
Yeah, so then what happened was that there was a rape in an Uber in Delhi many years back. And that kind of really, really triggered me. I said, where are the women drivers? And that just, in that 1 minute, I changed my mind and I decided that I wanted to become a cabbie and I wanted to set up a company like this, which drives women and kids. And that was it. That's how life just changed. Overall, we started training men from the marginalized communities. 6 to 8 months, we trained them in driving. And then these women started driving different schools. So we were more like alternate moms dropping kids to school. Cab became just a dabba around it, basically. And in such good 6 years, it's been a fantastic journey. We, in fact, now also train women, women like you, to drive their own cars. There's a huge gap in the training industry as well, in your driving school industry, if I would call it. So now we have women training women how to drive, and we train women on their own cars. We're constantly refining this entire system of, mobility for women. That's what we do.
So also during unexpected time, you know, because nobody expected the pandemic to come in, maybe a couple of years earlier. So I'm sure it must have been really vulnerable to run the business during these times. So what are the changes that you actually had to make to still be in business?
Yeah, so I think one thing was that the cab industry took a very big hit because people didn't want to use a taxi anymore. They scared. Like, you know, what happens? Does the cabbie have COVID, or who was the last customer? So there were a lot of, you know, reservations out there. But this gave opportunity to what we call a taxi breakthrough. We realized that people didn't want to take cab, but they wanted to self-drive. And that's where the whole segment of us training women how to drive became the next segment that we launched. So out of this adversity that came in on one business, came out another business vertical, you know. So everything is not lost, you know. I mean, financially we were doomed for quite some time, but new vertical really helped us pick up and, you know, kind of survive and float through this.
What about you, Janvi? What are the changes that you
Yes, I mean, these have been very unprecedented and challenging times. I mean, for us, the most important was to take care of the health and safety of our karigars, weavers and employees. I mean, you know, the weavers and karigars who are in remote villages, I mean, you know, the awareness need to be kind of given to them that, I mean, so that they are all safe. That was the first and paramount importance. And then, yes, to run the business, to pay the salaries, to continue the innovation and development work, you needed the money, I mean, you needed to generate sales. Till now, you know, it was like for us, for a niche product like ours, it was very, I mean, we used to do a lot of physical events wherein people would touch, feel, and then see how, I mean, you know, drape and buy the things. And a lot of people who would travel, who would visit our studio and then meet us, hear the story about the each product and then buy. That used to be our major, selling model. But that had to be completely, I mean, changed now. So then that's when, we decided to do online events. And what I feel very blessed and fortunate is our clientele, which have been with us through the journey, I mean, they just stood by us. I mean, I think somewhere we must have done something right that everybody said, we need to support them in these challenging times and then make sure that they are able to sustain. So we did, all the new developments that we did, we started, I mean, honestly, I'm not a very tech-savvy person. Okay. So, you know, our social media was, I mean, we hadn't explored it as much. We hadn't done online sales so much, but then this gave us no option. So then the stories that we would talk to them, we started kind of communicating them over social media and we started doing online events. These online events, I mean, organizations like Craft Council of Karnataka, the Handloom and Textile Commission, they all supported us in whichever way they could. And quite a few of these events were very successful, wherein we were able to generate funds so that we paid all our salaries and we were able to continue with the innovation work. So far, I mean, though I would definitely say, I mean, it's not been great growth or anything, but we've been able to sustain so far and then just hope, you know, we are able to continue whatever weaver community or the karigars that we work with, we just want to make sure their bread and butter and their livelihood is taken care of. So these online events and then sales came in very, very, helpful in these times, which was a big change from the way we used to work earlier. Yes.
That's so wonderful to hear. And, you know, something I'm picking up on after listening to both of you speak was a lot of concern towards the employment as well. You know, it was not just about running a business, but there is a concern for the people you're providing employment to, be it the weavers or be it the women drivers. So, you know, how important was this in your, you know, how importantly did it play out in your decision?
very important, because you know, I mean, unless and until you take care of your team, you build something along, I mean, in the unless your employees have that trust on you, I mean, it doesn't go a long way. So for that, it's very, very important that every decision that you take is in a way that every person involved in the organization or involved with your business is taken care of in the decision. So it was very important to kind of consider all the aspects when you kind of weigh your pros and cons, because every day you had to take new decisions which nobody knew these kinds of situations would arise, right? I mean, it was, the problems were only very different. You didn't have any guidelines as to how to go about. So, I mean, we just decided, come what may, the first thing is we need to kind of make sure the well-being of everyone involved is maintained and then taken care of. And that was a driving force in any decision.
Very true, very true, very true.
Looks first, like we have Vandana back with us. Yes, so, we'll also hear her out. So, Vandana, I was just, speaking with Janvi about how important the decision of employing the weavers or the women drivers in your case was, you know, in playing out towards this whole decision of running a business. Do shed some light on it from your end.
I think
looks like we've lost her again. You know, these unfortunate network issues that we are now living with.
Yes.
But now this has become a way of life for us, because, you know, network issues, the network problems. So, like, we just have got used to it, and we have, like, sort of started overcoming this and then working around it, basically.
Yes.
So, till Vandana comes and we'll ask her the same question again. But we're not like that. But I'm sure when you started on this, I mean, you know, when this idea actually came in and when you started, you know, faced a lot of challenges, by way of, it could be different kind of challenges. Oh, I think Vandana is coming back. Yes, Vandana is back. So we go back to the question. Janvi,
yes. Started.
Yes, Vandana.
See, about this totally non-technical.
Work around it. Don't worry. This is always happening. It's absolutely fine. Yes, Vandana.
We don't get nervous, no? We don't get nervous with network.
Yeah, true.
Okay, shoot.
Maybe let me just repeat your question again.
Sure. Vandana, am I audible now?
Yes, I hope I'm better off. I got my earphones.
Yes, you are.
Perfect. So, you know, we were discussing with Janvi about how importantly the thought of providing employment featured in, you know, starting your business. So do shed some light from your end on how important it was for you to provide employment to, you know, the women drivers in your case.
It obviously our concept itself was very different. They were never just taxi drivers for us. Like I said, we were always alternate moms. So they were also shown the leadership that by doing this career, it's not just a job as a taxi driver that you're picking up here. You are responsible for keeping children safe. All of us women, children have seen abuse. That's where your Me Too came, right? I don't think anybody got messed up. Maybe somebody didn't write on Facebook about it is a separate issue, but I think we all face this. So when I spoke to my girls about, listen, this is what they're going to do, it was, everything was then beyond a job. Everything was about her purpose in life. You know, and that worked beautifully for us. The motherhood was what we really banked on. During the pandemic, I mean, it was mayhem. I think as an organization, I was crying like mad because I didn't know how to pay them now, because, you know, so many of them and business was suddenly so low, and ours was a very predictable school pick up and drop business. And suddenly it was like at zero. So, I mean, we managed to take care of them for 7 to 8 months. After that, I mean, I have a very, very low team. So we really had to downsize to just keep ourselves afloat. Those women are really calling even now, saying that, ma'am, when does this whole thing start again? So we want to come back. And it's actually very overwhelming to get these calls. you know, beyond a point, I think it really, really hit us hard. We were in debt. We took a lot of debt to pay their salaries. But beyond that, even we couldn't absorb their, you know. So we're really waiting for schools to get back into, you know, action. But yes, in the meanwhile, the driving training business has kept us afloat. But quite a few people have lost their jobs. And I mean, it's a sad reality of today.
To be very honest, we all are waiting for, you know, things to get back to normal and we get back to a normal. Yes. But at the same time, you know, we'd also like to know that when you actually started this business, I'm sure that, you know, faced a lot of challenges when you started, because when the idea, you got the idea and when you wanted to actually implement it, you know, faced a lot of challenges. So might be, you can just tell us, might be Vandana can start now and just tell us what are the challenges that you actually faced, might be just in short, so that, you know, even the people who are listening, they would like to, I'm sure many of them have ideas, but they don't know how to go about it. This could actually sort of, you know, help how you overcome the challenges and you still went ahead and started your business. So Mandy, Vandana, you can tell, and okay, we've lost Vandana again. So Mandy, we go back to you, Janvi.
Yeah. So, I mean, the first thing of, the idea of employment creation, giving work to weavers and karigars that Taru asked, I feel that's the core of our business. Our social enterprise started because we wanted to give an identity to arts and crafts and give continuous work and employment to weavers and karigars. And weaving is a family profession. I mean, everyone in the family is involved. The women help in setting the loom and do the support activities wherein the men weave. And the elderly women also take up activities like reeling and things which, you know, do not need a very strong eye power and things like this. So everyone is involved. So, and also the support activities create a lot of employment for women in the villages who are uneducated, who otherwise are not able to do a lot of hard, I mean, once they are not capable of doing hard work in the fields and the farms and the physical labor, this is something that helps them earn their livelihood sitting at home. So that was one of the major driving force in starting Kalinele. Other than that, also, I mean, we give employment to a lot of women in the sense, embroiderers in and around villages of Dharwad. So we, also train women who want to learn embroidery, and then we try and make sure that we give them enough work so they are able to learn, earn their living, sitting in the comforts of their home. And here in Bangalore, the migrant labor wives, we've created a small product of lard which comes out of the scrap that gets left after we finish all our production, that goes to these women who create this. We've taught them to make these tiny little flasks which go as our packaging detail and embellishment for most of the products. So, you know, somewhere we try and create employment to these underprivileged people who otherwise, you know, who not for some reason, either, the young mothers or the old people who are not able to engage in other kind of work, who, we try and give them work so that they're able to earn some livelihood. So this is the whole idea behind the starting Kalinele. And when we do this also, somewhere everywhere we try and create these few micro entrepreneurs when we see a capability, so that, you know, we encourage more and more people to kind of gain that confidence to do something on their own. Like, for example, the embroidery cluster that we work with, we identified one lady who's educated, who's able to train and manage the rest of the people. Over the years, we said, now you run this as a small enterprise of your own and supply to us. We'll take it on a regular basis. And then, you know, that way you kind of take a lot more, they start taking a lot more ownership and then try and build that the community for themselves, and more women get motivated. That's the idea.
Yeah, basically, I think, Janvi, what you actually would have felt as a challenge would have been more in the, getting them trained in the tech, in the particular, designing or...
No, this I was trying to... Taru, yes. What she asked in terms of the employment opportunities. And then in terms of challenges, the biggest challenge was to gain the trust of weavers to kind of get into doing something different for us, which was very difficult initially. And then over a period of, and for me, it was very difficult, challenging to go sit with them, convince them to kind of do newer things for us, because we're two growing up boys and family requirement. Husband was a techie who traveled quite extensively. So it was difficult for me to go spend time with them, explain to them as to like, you know, what is the bigger vision and things. That was the biggest challenge that we faced, which over a period of time with, consistent work, regular persistent working with them, and when they realize that we are trying to look at their well-being, over the years they have agreed, and then, you know, there's it all works like a big family wherein we kind of see the bigger aims and goals together and try and achieve them all together. Yes.
Absolutely. It is, you know, you feel very triumphant when you're actually able to overcome challenges. What about you, Vandana? Yes. I'm sure you faced a lot of challenges when you actually wanted to start. And how did you actually overcome these challenges? Vandana? I think you're in mute, Vandana. Yeah. Vandana, are you able to hear? Vandana, are you able to hear me? Are the others able to hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Vandana, I think issue with Vandana's network. Yeah.
Facing some audio issue, Vandana.
Sure. So I think till Vandana joins back, let's sort of continue on. And, you know, Janvi, you were just mentioning that, you had your two children, your husband was traveling constantly. There's a lot of all of that going on the personal front. So, you know, how did you manage this work-life balance, especially when your business is also your baby?
Yeah, I think first of all, I had to just, set my own expectation, right, that this is what I'll be able to kind of manage. And, you know, because you want to kind of do everything in terms of your work also, at home also. So making peace with what is realistic, what is possible, was very, very important. Setting the priorities right, and wherever possible, I tried to outsource, and then, you know, try to made the team able to kind of take their own decisions and manage, so that, you know, we were, even if I had some limitations, nothing stopped. So that was what we were trying to achieve. Yes, but it's probably, couldn't grow as much as we could have because of these challenges. But then I think, you know, there is always a time when you can do that. For me, it was very, very important that you have a happy family too. So that you don't regret. So just, try to see what is possible and then set up definite goals, achieve them, and then move to the next. I think that's what, okay, we have Vandana.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm like this disappearing person today.
No worries at all.
Get happy about it. As far as you come back, so we are actually happy about it.
I'm playing like hide and seek around him.
You know, we were just discussing challenges, and I feel like this is such a big challenge currently. ensuring you have the right network, people can hear. You see so many memes about all of this.
I changed from Wi-Fi to mobile network, and that's equally bad. So, where will I go?
So, we say challenges, and Vandana is off. We'll not ask her that question again.
I think for us, challenges have been seriously like a seesaw. Okay, one challenge goes, then the other one comes, and then it's like, oh my God, how do I balance this? So I think the first challenge we really faced was nobody wanted to become a taxi driver. Okay. And I was like, arey yaar, bahut acha career hai. I'll teach you how to drive gaadi and all that. So women didn't want to come. Okay. Not a single woman wanted to come. So I was like, beggars can't be choosers. And I really had to kiss ass to bring them inside. Okay. Point number one. I realized what was happening, and this I got out of my experience of being a taxi driver, that women were scared to come and become a taxi driver. It's like, who will I drive? Some customer will be there, maybe he'll molest me. You know, how safe am I? Where will I wake up? Where will I end during the day? Maybe I live in Jakur and I let end up in Whitefield, then what will I do? So they had all these concerns. Now that's where we designed the business that let's do these fixed route businesses every single day. We drive kids to school. So first of all, you know your clientele are kids. They're not going to do anything to you, right? You're safe. So we designed the business around her, first making her safe, you know? And then it's like every day you're going to drive the same school children. So you know your routes are fixed. You're not lost. You're closer to home. Mornings drop the smaller children. Then go home, yeah. Go home and do your cooking, geeking. Come back again to pick up the kids. It was giving them a work-life balance. So I think that that was like the biggest hurdle we had, you know. Secondly, was their training. They had never sat in a car. But like 5 kilometers was Timbuktu for them. And suddenly I'm telling her, hey, listen, you have to drive this car and professionally drive it. Oh my God, you know, it was a nightmare trying to train them. But I think over the years, we've really perfected this art of training women. And now it's become a business vertical for us, you know, to train everybody. But the point was that initially, it was extremely difficult getting them to drive. They were so scared, my God. And in their homes, everybody telling them, what women and all will drive like this? Where you think you're, you know, president of a country? There was a lot of patriarchy issues they faced at home. They started talking back to their families in the house. Our biggest dropout happened, not because she wasn't making enough. She was making actually more than the men in the house. And the family started pulling them back. Arey, ye ladki to ab bolti hai, isko to jawan aa gayi hai. She's able to speak loudly now. You know, so it was like a major lifestyle change that happened in these women's lives. And we had to tone them down. We literally had to tone them. Hey, listen, you, I know you're superwoman, but your family can't know you're superwoman. You know, they throw you out of the house. So they just toned down a little bit. So we had very, very weird challenges, actually. You know, not like the regular stuff at all. Every day was like, ab kya karun main? You know, what do I do next now? How do I solve this? Yeah.
As you're talking about this, Vandana, we'd also like to know about the World Bank Award that you got. If you could just tell us something about that too. I'm sure we really know about
that. That was like the most exciting. It was like an Oscar in my life. Okay. I mean, if you come to my office, it's one small, it's a 50 square foot office with literally, you know, we had 4 chairs over there. That's about it. Now we've downsized to literally 1 chair. Okay, what to do? Life is reality bites now. But I'm telling you, it was such a small office. And, you know, getting recognized by the World Bank for something like this, because of the impact that we were creating, we were keeping children safe. We were not just empowering women. They, in turn, were keeping children safe. They were keeping the next generation safe, right? And as small as my operations were, I think the World Bank realized that maybe this is the way to really pave the path for the next generation. So out of 188 countries, 1,200 applications, we actually, a small little team out of a 50 square foot office, actually got the World Bank Award. I mean, that's something where, you know, the prime ministers of the country go to Washington to talk, and here was I. I was super thrilled. I still have, you know, blood gushing in my cheeks when I'm talking about that experience, you know, and everybody listening to you, I mean, it was amazing. And I was so proud of my country, you know, out there, standing over there and talking, hey, listen, I did this in India. Tumne kya kya? You know what I'm saying? It was a proud moment. Very, very proud moment.
We are really feeling proud that, you know, you are a panel and you've got a
so amazing and so inspiring, really, Vandana. So, you know, another question to both of you from one of our viewers is, as women, how can we create an environment around us and take steps towards becoming an entrepreneur? The question is from Toshiba.
Oh, this is very interesting. Okay. I must tell you, Toshiba, that the day I decided to become a taxi driver, and I told my mom very happily, she fell off her seat. Okay. She literally was like, oh my God, what's up with you? You know, you left your investment banking and I'm a single mom, okay, so I run the whole family. It's like, you left this cushy career to become a taxi driver, okay? And, you know, later on, a month later, I didn't even tell my brother, okay? So it's a total woman company and all this. Then my mom went and told my brother that this is what happened. Oh God, am I lost?
No, you're there. You're very much there.
You're very much there.
Very much there, Vandana.
Am I here?
Yes.
Ah, okay. So the thing was that later on, my brother decided, you know, my mom told my brother, and my brother started crying. He was like, oh my God, what in the world happened to my sister? She wants to become a taxi driver. Okay. He started crying on the phone. I said, shut up and come home. I'll tell you the rest of the story. Okay. Now he comes home and suddenly he's like, wow, this is a great industry. Why haven't you taken me as an investor into this? The tables turned, okay, totally. And suddenly my mom was like, oh, this must be something really good you're doing, you know, because there was one more person in the family who joined, right? So the thing is that families, yes, they do have shocking element and they get shocked, okay? But slowly, slowly, if you just push the envelope, thoda, then everything sets into place. So don't get worried. It's like suddenly you go home and you say, I want to marry this man. What will everybody say? What the hell are you doing? Right? It's the same way. Then you have to slowly, slowly push the envelope inside. Don't lose heart. It happens.
Janvi, we'd love to hear some thoughts from you too.
Yeah, I mean, it obviously takes a lot of courage, and everybody in the family, I mean, as Vanda just pointed out, I mean, you know, it's a lot of people in the family. Everybody, we would want you to do well, be happy, and then be comfortable. So when you come up with something as drastic as this, yes, it does take time for everyone to digest it. I mean, especially when you're in a cushy job. But for me, because of family, I mean, you know, requirements and the responsibilities, I'd already taken a break of 6 years. I was doing on and off, some kind of work related to textiles, but nothing substantial as this. I was doing some bit of freelancing work. So when I told I would want to do this, so the first this thing was, no harm trying. You know, but with anybody I spoke to, they said ki North Karnataka weavers, it's not going to be very easy, and it is not easy. You know, I mean, there are times that excitedly I call them in the afternoon at around 2 to place an order. They say, what madam, this is the time to sleep. Why are you calling now? Call us at 5 o'clock. You know, I mean, it is like they themselves, I mean, they follow a thing, they sit on their loom at around 9, and then by 1 they shut, they eat, they sleep, and they around they get up in the evening and start their day, and then they don't want to do anything different what they have been doing for over the years. So, you know, people who didn't know the industry, I mean, like, as my family hardly knew about what I was doing, because nobody is from textile industry. So for them, it was a different way, whether, I mean, you know, like entrepreneurship in general is not an easy path to take up kind of a thing. But whereas people who knew industry said, oh my goodness, I mean, you know, that is a cluster that is so difficult to work with. Will you be able to kind of manage it kind of a thing? But I think, I mean, you know, if you really have that passion and conviction somewhere, things start falling in place. But you do need to have a lot of diligence and patience to see it through what you see. You know, it's not very easy that way. But somewhere we fairly managed kind of convincing everybody involved in it, and then moved on, and then it's been an okay thing so far. Yes. Yeah.
So actually, before we proceed, you know, we would like to show you a interesting video as to how, you know, when a small incident, like, I mean, of course, Vandana did refer to the incident, but just to show it in a video form, like how a small incident can get converted into a business idea. So this will actually give all the people over here who might have some ideas, and then, you know, can actually think about even converting it. So I would just like to show you a small video, and then we'll continue after the video.
Sure.
Founder of Taxi. Taxi is an organization which focuses on women child safety by a very simple solution of having women driving women and children. Now, what we do is we train women from the marginalized communities, give them skills of life skills of driving over 6 to 8 months, top it up with self-defense. More than anything else, these women, once they are ready, they drive a lot of children to schools and tutorials, as well as women for their offices and late night airport drives. So in this way, we are actually curbing child sexual abuse and violence against women while on their roads. Now, we have been the proud recipients of the HDFC Smartup grant. Let me tell you, this grant has been like a lifesaver for us. This grant came just in time while the pandemic arrived on all of us, and we were totally devastated because nobody wanted to take cabs anymore. First of all, business was shut down for so long. The amount we received from these grants really, really helped us afloat. That's so important for any entrepreneur, right? To be able to, you know, pay the salaries and keep the team alive till the things tide over. And this is what this grant really did for us. In the meanwhile, we were focusing on how to survive this and how to move. So while schools, etc., are opening hopefully next July, we have already started training women. So we have about 50 women who are now training this year to get into the driving module and be ready for the next June and July. In the meanwhile, the business also pivoted in a different way. So while we realized that cabs were something and public transport was something that the people did not prefer anymore, there was here a huge demand from people to self-drive. And this again gave us the opportunity. So we were training women to become cabbies. Now we were training customers how to drive their own cars. So these same women drivers who were, you know, possibly driving cabs today were using their skill, their knowledge, their experience to train clients how to drive their own cars. Most of the women face this problem wherein they would have taken up driving many, many years back, and then somewhere somebody would have needled them, oh, women can't drive, oh this, oh that, and they have left out their driving. And we are giving them a safe opportunity once again to learn how to drive. And this vertical is called Taxi Break Free because it's allowing women to break free out of their fears and, you know, take it further. I'm really, really thankful to the HDFC Smartup grant, and I would really encourage every single social venture out here. You know, you want to make a difference, please do apply to this grant. Thank you so much.
It was so inspiring to see this, and take one of the questions from one of the audience, Vanita Balu. She asked that, how did you overcome the investment challenges that you faced? I'm sure when you started with your initiative, you'd have had a lot of investment. And so how did you actually, you know, overcome these challenges?
I don't think I ever overcame it. I'm struggling with it all the time. You know, but you know what? Actually, my investment came from my family and friends. Okay, my very, very close friends who believed in me, who knew that this woman is mad enough to make this happen, and that trust level came from them. Otherwise, I'm still waiting. Hello, you know. But then the difference is, honestly speaking, for anybody who's starting up, right, the pressure on you from the society that, you know, you need funding to do this, you need to grow very big, very fast. It's a lot of pressure, okay? It's a lot like how we women, when we grow up, when we are kids, our mothers will tell us, you know, cook nicely, you'll get married one day, and then, you know, that house will go in. Like, you know, searching for investors is like that only, the pressure. Already you are supposed to look good, and you're supposed to dress up for some fellow who will come God knows when, okay? Other than that, you know, while those investors are there, make your own business sustainable. You know, when our parents ran their mom and pop shops, right, they worked on profitability. Right from day one, how do you ensure that you do this much kharcha only and you get profitable? So we are a profitable company, but we may not be a very big company. We are a small company. I just didn't want to wait around, you know, like wait for that groom to come later. I mean, I thought it was important that I survive on my own, and great, if he comes along, wow, we'll grow bigger. You know what I'm saying? So I think startups need to just allow themselves not to get under that pressure of that glossary of that investments all the time. It's a myth. It doesn't happen to everybody. Yeah? Just relax.
So, you also touched upon, you know, the HDFC grant and everything. So I'm sure that gives an idea to a lot of people about how they can go about this. I'd like to, since we're almost running out of time, quickly take a question by Savita Prakash. And, so she asks, what are the guidelines you want to give aspiring youngsters? And also, Janvi, if we could also have a word of advice, you know, if you could just give like one line of advice to women entrepreneurs, to aspiring women entrepreneurs, and obviously Vandana, you as well. So Janvi, if you could go first.
I would say, for starting any enterprise, passion and conviction in what you're doing is very, very important. Otherwise, it's very difficult to take the long haul that it would take. So I think that's what I would give a one-line advice to anybody who wants to start. You need to be very, very convinced about what you have taken up, and with a lot of diligence and patience, you need to work at it, and that's what is going to make it for you. Yeah.
And Vandana,
I have a financial advice. Since I was an investment banker, so everything around moves for with money. So I learned this the hard way. Is that we women, we always, when we do something with a lot of passion, we invariably put all our money inside into the business, right? But you have to be very selfish. 2 years of your own personal home running expenses, forget about the rest of this right now. 2 years of your own running expenses, first you put that in a fixed deposit, okay? That is not to be touched for your business. That is for your food and your family's food. Be selfish. Your children's education. Have that much money in your account first. Then do business. Don't play with your own life. Yes, passion is important and everything is important. But then your family, you have to be selfish. We women are just too much of givers, I think. Apni jaan bhi bachani chahiye. I think 2 years of cash flow should be in the bank.
You just said, like, you know, in the flight, you put your air mask first and then you put it for the others.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think we women discount us big time, somewhere. I feel, we just jump in.
Absolutely wonderful, inspiring and very practical advice. So, I really would like to thank you both. And, now more than ever, we need to come together into a collective of positivity, to help drive this positive change. And, this is what Wiki also aims to do.
So, on behalf of Wiki, we thank you both for coming here and sharing your experiences with us. And we also request all the viewers, we also thank all the viewers who have come in. And please do, do follow our Wiki page and all the social media so that you'll get an update of all the upcoming events. And I would just like to say that keep safe, keep healthy. In these times of uncertainty, this will surely pass. Signing off, Kala Kadasikam.
Thank you so much.
And I'm Daru Girdonia. Thank you, Janvi and Vandana.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye-bye.